Okay, good morning, and thank you very much for inviting me here. I guess I am the only non-surgeon in this room, but I am glad to be here. I am learning a lot about modern oncological surgery, which is quite different from what I learned in medical school almost 50 years ago. So I am learning, and I hope that you will learn a little bit about biochemistry, basic biochemistry, because it has an impact on cancer. And as you will see, after many years, it seems that the basic research that we have done in our laboratory in biochemistry of the ubiquitin system is impacting the basic biology of cancer also, among other diseases. I am interested for, as you heard, for many years in the problem of how proteins are degraded in cells. And the first slide gives you a general idea. Pointer. So, as you may remember, proteins are made of building blocks, amino acids, and we have thousands of different proteins, each of which has a different function after being assembled from these building blocks. And the difference between the proteins is in the sequence in which the building blocks, the amino acids, are arranged in this chain of the proteins. And the sequence is determined by the DNA, by our genes. So the gene is the kind of the blueprint, and the protein carries out the functions. And when I started working in biochemistry, there was a lot of interest in protein synthesis and how amino acids are assembled into proteins based on the information in genes, and how this gene expression is turned on and off. And when I saw this a bit crowded, or very crowded. Many people are working on the same problem of protein synthesis. And I got interested in the opposite process, in which very few people were interested because they thought it was not important, of protein degradation. Because our proteins are not only made all the time by synthesis, but also disassembled all the time back to amino acids, which looks wasteful and not interesting, but actually it has some interesting functions. And these are the main functions of protein degradation that actually were known at that time, but people didn't pay attention. One is to get rid of abnormal proteins. The structure of our proteins, which is the three-dimensional structure, is a very delicate structure. It gets very easily damaged, and the protein becomes abnormal or misfolded. And when it becomes abnormal or misfolded, it interferes with the function of the cells. For example, you heard, of course, of neurodegenerative diseases such as Parkinson's disease or Alzheimer's disease. In part, they are caused by abnormal proteins that accumulate there and kill certain neurons. So that this doesn't appear, it doesn't happen more often, is due to a very efficient degradation of abnormal proteins by these protein degradation systems. But the protein degradation system also degrades some normal proteins at certain times, and these are regulatory proteins. These are proteins that have to act for a very short limit window of time. So it's kind of like a switch off. The protein function is turned on by synthesis, but it's turned on by destroying these proteins. Let us imagine that the cell is like a big orchestra, a huge orchestra, which has thousands of players, the different proteins, and there is one player, the trumpet player, that has to play a tune at a certain time. It will get up, it will play the tune, but then it has to stop. If the trumpet player does not stop, he will ruin the symphony. So we don't want that. And in the cell, this is made by the degradation. It's a drastic way. It destroys the trumpet player, but that is a very efficient way. So protein degradation has important functions, and my question was, how are cellular proteins degraded at a very selective and regulated mode? How does the cell knows to destroy one certain protein, let us say this trumpet player, out of the thousands of different proteins that we have in our cells? So that wasn't known at that time. And then I returned from San Francisco, as you heard, and I learned about the problem there when I was a postdoctoral fellow. I returned to Haifa, to the Technion, set up my my research group, and continued to study how proteins are degraded in cells. And the way we did it was by biochemistry. In biochemistry, the cell is opened up, and the different components are separated and analyzed, and then put back together. And I kind of liken to how we want to learn how a watch works, a mechanical watch. We want to open it, otherwise we can describe that it shows the time, but we don't know how does it work. If we want to know how does it work, we open it up, we take out the different parts, the springs and the wheels, examine them, and when we put them back together and the watch works again, then we really understood how the watch works. So that's what we did. We began to biochemically dissect extracts, which are cells that are opened up, that carry out protein degradation. And the first big advance was about 10 years later, when we isolated one component, one important component of the system, which is called ubiquitin. It is shown in the next slide. This shows the structure of ubiquitin as we know it now. It is a small protein, very compactly folded. This doesn't show the amino acids, just the general folding or shape of the protein. It is a very compact protein, but it has one end which is free, which is kind of flexible. And this end is kind of the business end of ubiquitin, because that is where it gets linked to proteins and marks them for degradation. So at first we just isolated ubiquitin, this kind of isolated one wheel of this watch, and we didn't know how it worked. But shortly afterwards, 2 years later, we understood how it works. It works by marking proteins for degradation. So when the ubiquitin gets linked to a protein through this flexible end, it is kind of a mark. It marks this protein has to be degraded. And the complete bit, and then we worked on the complete system to try to understand how the whole system works. And this is shown in the next slide. This is kind of an outline of the biochemistry of the ubiquitin-dependent protein degradation system. I won't go into all the details, but the system contains two main phases. The first phase is the marking of the protein by linking it up to ubiquitin. So the protein is not yet degraded, but it is marked. And then in the second phase, the protein that is linked to ubiquitin is degraded by a degradation machinery. So in the first phase, this is the protein that has to be destroyed, this orange fellow here. And the ubiquitins are represented by these little blue balls. So ubiquitin is linked, and it is linked by several enzymes, out of which the important one is the third one, the E3, or E3 ubiquitin ligases, because this is the enzyme that recognizes to which protein ubiquitin has to be linked. And now we know of about 600 different E3 enzymes, E3 ubiquitin protein ligases, that each of which recognizes a certain protein and marks it, links ubiquitin to it and marks it for degradation. So the heart of the system is this third enzyme, the E3 ubiquitin ligase, that ligates ubiquitins. Now, as you can see here, actually not one ubiquitin, but a chain of ubiquitin is attached to the protein. So this is the protein that is doomed for degradation. And in the second phase, the protein that has been marked by ubiquitins is degraded by a structure in the cell that is called the proteasome. The proteasome is like a barrel with a cavity inside. And the protein that has been marked by ubiquitin, the protein is kind of stuffed inside and is destroyed inside the cavity. There are sites, proteolytic sites, that destroy it and chop it up to small pieces. Ubiquitin stays outside and can be reused again. So it is like, if you want, a food processor. Only things that are stuffed inside are getting chopped up, but it is a very sophisticated proteasome. It's a very sophisticated food processor. It doesn't chop up every protein. It only chops up proteins that has been marked for degradation by ubiquitin. So that is how the thousands of different proteins, out of the thousands of different proteins, the thousands are not degraded, but only a certain proteins are degraded, those that has been marked by ubiquitin. So this is the essence of the basic biochemistry of the ubiquitin system, and after we found out how the basic biochemistry work, even though there were some details to be worked out, I turn to the problem of what are the functions of ubiquitin-mediated protein degradation in the cell. And that is how I became interested in the roles of the ubiquitin system in the cell division or cell cycle. And the next slide is taken from a basic textbook, which shows what people, pathologists and cytologists knew for 100 years, that the cell division cycle is occurring it has different phases, the G1 phase, which is the first phase, and then in which the cell enlarges its contents, duplicates its contents of protein, and an important part is the S phase, when the DNA is synthesized and is duplicated. So now the cell has a double amount of DNA and protein, and then the cell, the DNA is condensed into chromosome, and we have mitosis in which the cell divides and two identical new daughter cells are made. So, and then it goes so on and so on, as you know. So that was known, but it was not known what are the molecules, what is the molecular mechanism that makes the cells to divide. And very important work by other investigators found that the main molecules are proteins that we are called cyclins. Cyclins are the regulators, these are the regulators that regulate the cell division. And we have different cyclins, and each cyclin goes up and down, and when it goes up, it kind of pushes cells into the next stage of the cell division. So here we have the same cell division cycle, but represented in a linear fashion. So to go from the G1 to the S phase, for example, at the beginning of cell division, a certain cyclins, with the G1 cyclins, go up and then go down. And then so on, other cyclins will go up and down in different phases of the cell cycle. Each will push the cell to the next stage, but then it has to be degraded. It has to disappear in order that the cell cycle will go on further. So here I got interested in this phase of the disappearance, of the causes the exact degradation of G1 cyclins in this phase of the cell cycle, of the M cyclins, of mitotic cyclins in this phase of the cycle. And there are also inhibitors of cyclins. For example, G1 cyclins are inhibited by a protein called P27. So P27, at the beginning of the cell cycle, before the cell begins to divide, or in non-dividing cells, P27 is very high, and it inhibits the G1 cyclin. If there is a little bit of G1 cyclin, it will not let it work. So then when the cell has to divide, P27 has to be destroyed, has to be degraded in order for the G1 cyclin to work. So it's kind of a break. You have to destroy the break so that the machine can go forward. So I got interested in this problem. What degrades the different cyclins at the right time of the cell cycle? What degrades the inhibitors of cyclins like this P27? And to find out what is the machinery, the main thing was to find what is the E3 ubiquitin ligase, what is the enzyme or enzymes that target these cyclins for degradation at the correct time. And indeed, in my laboratory, we identified several enzymes. One is called the SCF Skip2 ubiquitin ligase that targets this P27 inhibitor for degradation. And the very important enzyme is called APCC, which targets mitotic cyclins and other mitotic regulators for degradation and does allow cells to get out of mitosis, to get out of anaphase, actually, in mitosis, into the next cell cycle. So it took us some time to describe these enzymes and especially the regulation of these enzymes in the cell cycle, which is very important, what makes them work only at a certain time of the cell division on the right place. So I won't go into details of these work, but that is what we have been doing after the basic discovery of the ubiquitin system. Now I would like to describe briefly what other investigators have been doing. So following our basic discovery of the basic biochemistry of the ubiquitin system, many other investigators got interested in the functions of ubiquitin protein-mediated protein degradation in health and in disease. And it turned out that in the healthy cells, ubiquitin-mediated protein degradation is involved in almost every basic cellular process. So a cell cannot really live without ubiquitin-mediated protein degradation because the ubiquitin-mediated destruction of regulatory proteins is involved in almost every basic process, such as I already showed you some aspects of the control of cell division, and there are many others, in the transduction of certain signals from outside of the cells to inside of the cells. Ubiquitin-mediated protein degradation is also involved in expression of certain genes, especially genes that are involved in responses to inflammation and immunity, in the formation of these NF-kappa-B regulator of inflammation. In many temporally controlled processes, such as in embryonic development, in apoptosis, both in apoptotic and anti-apoptotic phenomena. And of course, as I said, the quality control quality control function of getting rid of abnormal proteins is also a very important function of ubiquitin-mediated protein degradation. And as you may imagine, when a system is involved in so many basic cellular functions, is also involved in pathologies, and the ubiquitin system is indeed was found to be involved in many diseases, in many types of cancer, and I'll talk a little bit more about it because this is an oncological surgery meeting, in some neurodegenerative diseases such as Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and Huntington's. In each of them, certain proteins are accumulating aggregating, and this at least adding or contributes to the pathogenesis of these diseases by damaging the neurons in which they accumulate. The ubiquitin system is involved in certain types of mental retardation, not all of them, but certain types, in some viral diseases, and in muscle wasting such as cachexia, in which there is an abnormal stimulation of protein degradation which contributes to these cases of cachexia. So out of these, I will tell you a little bit more about the molecular basis of cancer, which I guess you know already about, but I will just reiterate some main features. So as you know, in cancer, important molecules are oncoproteins, which stimulate cell division, and tumor suppressor proteins that has the opposite function of restraining cell division, of inhibiting cell division. And normally, there is a kind of an equilibrium between the action of oncoproteins and tumor suppressor proteins in the control of cell division. Now, in many cancers, there is either increase in the levels of oncoproteins or decrease in the levels of tumor suppressor proteins, or both. I guess you know about that. What you may not know, that most oncoproteins and tumor suppressor proteins are in a state of turnover. So they are continuously synthesized and degraded. So they are continuously synthesized and degraded, and this makes possible the regulation of their levels. However, it also can make possible or can make abnormalities. So when an oncoprotein is not degraded, it will be formed, but not degraded, its level will go up. And when a tumor suppressor protein will be degraded too fast, its level will go down. So cancer can be caused, and now I'm talking about human cancer, cancer can be caused either by the lack of degradation of an oncoprotein or by the too rapid degradation of a tumor suppressor protein. And I show you some examples of these generalities. For example, in colon cancer, which you just talked about, as you, I'm sure you know, many cases of colon cancer, there are mutations in a gene called APC gene. Now, APC gene is actually involved in the degradation of an oncoprotein called beta-catenin. And when there is a mutation in APC, so which inactivates APC, beta-catenin will not be degraded, it will go up, and it will cause these cancers, mostly colon cancer, also some types of melanoma. Another example is cervical cancer, which is caused by human papilloma virus. In this case, the virus makes a protein called an E6, and E6 targets for degradation an important tumor suppressor, which is called P53, which is one of the main tumor suppressor proteins in the cells. So when P53 is degraded, its levels go down, and it cannot restrain cell division. So this is the way, what is thought to be the way in which the papillomavirus causes cancer. Now, the same tumor suppressor, P53, normally is degraded by another ubiquitin ligase called E3 ubiquitin ligase, called MDM2. And MDM2 is overexpressed in many cancers, mainly in sarcomas, and also in some cases of glioma or melanoma. And overexpression of MDM2 targets for degradation this tumor suppressor. Another interesting case is clear cell carcinoma, which is caused by mutations in the 4-hyperlindau protein, which is a subunit of a ubiquitin ligase. So when the protein, when the VHL or 4-hyperlindau protein is mutated, it is not active, and when it's not active, usually it targets for degradation some hypoxia-inducible enzymes. So when it is not active, there is upregulation of these hypoxia-inducible enzymes, and these tumors now can survive in an anoxic environment. So this is the way which is thought in which this mutation in the VHL causes cancer. In some other examples, the oncoproteins or the tumor suppressor proteins are components of the ubiquitin system itself. So it was first shown by Danny Hershko, who is my son, the surgeon, that there is an oncoprotein called SKIP2, which is a ubiquitin ligase subunit. And it is overexpressed in cancer. He showed it overexpressed in cancers such as colon cancers and breast cancer. Since then, many others found that SKIP2 is also overexpressed in many other cancers. Now, SKIP2 normally targets for degradation tumor suppressor, such as the P27 protein that I already mentioned. It is an inhibitor of the G1 cyclin, some other proteins. So overexpression of SKIP2, of the oncoprotein SKIP2 ubiquitin ligase subunit, decreases the levels of the tumor suppressor proteins and thereby contributes to carcinogenesis. And there are also some opposite cases in which the ubiquitin ligase subunit is a tumor suppressor protein. For example, there is a protein called FBXW7, which you don't have to remember, but it targets for degradation important oncoproteins such as cyclin E, MYC, or JUN. So normally it targets them for degradation, but when it is mutated, it cannot target them for degradation because it is inactivated and the levels of these oncoproteins go up and then they contribute to oncogenesis. So you see that the discovery of the, these are only some selected cases. Now there is huge literature about the involvement of the ubiquitin system in cancer. And I wanted to show it to you to see how the basic discovery, the basic discoveries in the basic biology of protein degradation eventually impact on the understanding of disease, including molecular oncology. And of course, once we, all these discoveries are made, pharmaceutical industry begins to be interested and try to develop new drugs targeted against the ubiquitin system or against different parts of the ubiquitin system. And there is already one drug that is in use in the, for the last 10 years. It is an inhibitor of the proteasome called Verqade or bortezomib. And it is very beneficial for the treatment of multiple myeloma. It actually changed, revolutionized the treatment of multiple myeloma and allows, in many, many cases, most cases actually, many more years of high quality survival, together with some other drugs. So for me, it's very satisfying to see, because I learned medicine after all many years ago, how my basic research actually impacts medicine and actually improves the lives of many thousands of patients. Now, I should say that this is a special case because it inhibits a non-specific target. It inhibits the proteasome. Now, if it inhibited, the proteasome is involved in the degradation of all proteins. If you inhibited, if you inhibited protein proteasome completely, you would kill the patient because he cannot live without protein degradation. But the trick is that, that it is given in doses in which the proteasome activity is only very partially inhibited, in which there are almost no side effects, very few side effects. But it is lethal to these myeloma cells. Myeloma cells, the proteasome is apparently overworked. There is a lot of abnormal protein made in myeloma cells. And therefore, a little bit of inhibition of these proteasome sends them into apoptosis and actually kills the myeloma cells selectively. But it would be much better to develop drugs targeted against the specific places in the ubiquitin system, mostly the E3 ubiquitin protein ligases. You would have a very specific targets. And actually, many drug companies are trying to do this. So, as you see, we came back to medicine and to oncology after all these years, and it's just an example. And I wanted to also mention that in biochemistry, and this is in all biomedical sciences, discoveries are not made by myself, but I was helped by many people in the lab, including my wife, Judy Hersko, who helped me not only at home, but also at work for many years. I had more than 30 graduate students, including Aaron Chahanover, who was my graduate student, very lucky, in a very critical time of the discovery of the ubiquitin system, shared with me the Nobel Prize. Also the Nobel Prize I was glad to share with Ernie Rose from Fox Chase Cancer Center, who was my collaborator at important parts of the world. Thank you very much for your attention.